Today is January 27th at 10:35 a.m. We're here in the Baker College Library interviewing Dr. Bhuchar for the Houston Asian American Archive.
So my name is pronounced Bhuchar, actually.
Bhuchar?
Yes.
Sorry about that.
Not a problem. It's spelled differently, though.
Okay. Bhuchar. My name is Sophie Lafferty, and Chelsey One is with me. So we're going to start out with some questions about your early life. First, where and when were you born?
So I was born at home, delivered by a midwife, in a very, very small town up north India called Nawanshahr. And I don't think our town even had a hospital when I was born. All births took place at home. So that's where I was born, June 30th, 1947.
And what was your childhood like? Did you stay in this town?
So actually, my dad moved to Bombay, which is now called Mumbai. Mm-hmm. He worked for the Federal Reserve Bank. So I really grew up in Mumbai. Although I was born in a little town, we moved to Mumbai. That's where I grew up.
Okay, and how many siblings do you have?
I have three brothers. I'm the oldest, and three other brothers. So we have four total.
What were your parents' occupations?
My dad worked for the Federal Reserve Bank. Right. And he rose later on to become their chief operating officer of the bank. And my mom was a homemaker.
Okay. And what sort of principles did they raise you on?
Well, first they always said you got to work hard, be honest, and then you can be whatever you want to be. We were not a very religious family, although we did participate a little bit in religion, but maybe prayers here and there, but not very ritualistic. We were not going regularly to the temple or things like this.
Mm-hmm. So they said you could be whatever you wanted. Did they have any career expectations for you and your brothers?
Not really. I wanted to be a stage actor. That's the only thing. Even really? My dad intervened. Said, no, you'll go hungry. Choose another path. But if I insisted, I don't think he would have stopped me.
Mm-hmm. And what do your siblings do now?
So we have four. Two of us are physicians and two are CPAs.
Okay. What languages did you speak at home?
At home we spoke Punjabi and some Hindi too.
Okay. And did you have any hobbies or extracurriculars growing up that you enjoyed?
Mostly we used to play cricket. That was the sports of India. And some soccer. Those are the main things.
Mm-hmm. And how would you describe your neighborhood or community?
So, you know, Mumbai being a big city like New York, everybody lived in apartments.
Mm-hmm.
So we lived in an apartment complex where I think there were about 600 apartments. Everybody worked for the bank.
Mm-hmm.
And so everybody knew each other. And the pressure for us to do well in school came not just from our parents, but from the community too, and our friends. We all played together, grew up together.
Mm-hmm. So when did you immigrate to the US?
1971, after finishing medical school.
Okay. Where in the US did you come to first?
So I came to Chicago. That was my first city. And then I was a year in Chicago. Then I moved to New Orleans to do internal medicine for 3 years. Then I moved to Houston to join MD Anderson to do my fellowship in oncology.
Okay. So was it just you who came to the US or did any other family members?
I came alone, and then a year later I got married and my wife came with me.
Okay. You got married in India?
In New Delhi, yes.
Okay. So did you have any difficulty adjusting to life in the US?
As far as the language goes, no, because you know India is a major English speaking country. All my schooling was in English. The medical school is in English. So language, no. But otherwise, there were things to learn about the neighborhood, the culture, and which wasn't that difficult when you're young, you adjust faster.
Mm-hmm. So all of your family relatives are still in India?
No, only one brother's there. I have another brother in Houston who's also a physician in Sugarland, and a brother in New York who's a CPA.
Mm-hmm.
And the brother in Mumbai is also a CPA, lives there six months.
Okay. But they all immigrated to the U.S. after you were the first?
After me, yes.
Okay. So what was your schooling like first in India and then continuing your... You finished medical school in India and then did a fellowship in the U.S.?
Yeah. So all my schooling up to high school was all Catholic schools.
Okay.
Then my pre-med was also a religious-based school, which was a Hindu school. And then my medical school was a Protestant church-run school. So I had all this religious experience.
Yeah. What was that like? How did that play into the classroom experience?
I think the Catholic school experience was good. They were very, very strict. I mean, you didn't fool around with them. And that sort of put us into this work mode that we have to do, discipline, being a good citizen, you know. I think the Catholic school background was very, very helpful.
Mm. And then, so what was your fellowship like in the U.S.?
So the internship was done in Chicago.
Okay.
Then I moved to New Orleans. And I was busy all the time in the hospital taking care of patients, so our only experience outside was my wife and I going out to eat. And New Orleans those days, Walgreens had food counters, which you don't have anymore.
Mm.
We could sit there and order hamburger, french fries, whatever you want. And then our first experience with Mexican food was in New Orleans. I don't know if you remember, there was a restaurant chain called Pancho's. They've gone out of business. You could eat for $1.49 a dinner. So mostly we would go to Walgreens, Poncho, because that's all we could afford to.
Mm-hmm. How did you like American and Mexican food compared to Indian food?
Hamburgers I loved, french fries I loved, still love them. The Mexican food took a little time to get used to, but once we got used to it, we love it.
Okay. And why did you choose to do the internship in Chicago and then come to Houston?
Sitting in India, you only knew few cities in America. I had an offer in Arizona too. It was Maricopa County, I never heard the name. Chicago, everybody knew, you know, from the movies. So I thought Chicago would be better.
And then why New Orleans?
That's where I got my internal medicine. So once you finish your internship, then you have to reapply for internal medicine or surgery, whatever you want to do.
Okay.
So I applied around. I found New Orleans. Chicago was too cold for me. I froze in summer. So I thought New Orleans would be a good place to move to. Mm-hmm. So I moved to New Orleans.
And then Houston, you moved when you got your first job as a...
No, to continue my education in fellowship.
Oh, okay.
So I chose oncology. Right. So I came to Houston to train in oncology.
Right, okay.
At MD Anderson.
Mm-hmm. And why did you decide to stay in Houston?
Houston?
Mm-hmm.
Because MD Anderson was world renowned, they offered me a job, mm-hmm. and everybody told me, you can't miss this. Very few people get this chance, so go take it.
Yeah.
All my teachers in New Orleans, my professors, said this is an opportunity of a lifetime, don't miss it. So I moved.
What made you decide to study oncology?
you know, when I was in eighth, ninth grade, even before I decided I'm going to go to medicine, somehow I was attracted to taking care of cancer and cancer patients. So I thought originally I would go do research. But then when I started working in oncology, I discovered I'm more gifted in taking care of patients. Direct patient care was, I did that better than doing research. So I started going into patient care.
So can you tell us about your work with treatments for lung cancer?
So in 1975-76, there were barely any medications, not too much chemotherapy, not too many drugs available. So I had a chance to work with lung cancer patients. I used to run the lung cancer clinic at MD Anderson, but we barely had any medications, and platinum had just come out, new medications. It was being tried in testicular cancer with very, very good results. So I had a chance to work with cisplatinum at that time, worked for about 18 months. Then I went into private practice. But later on, platinum became a big part of lung cancer therapy and other therapies.
Mm-hmm. And we saw on your CV that you were named Physician of the Year in 2004. What was that like?
Oh, that was a big honor, really big honor. And that's, it's the hospital, the nurses, the other physicians, patients, they give you a name. So I was lucky to get that. Very honored.
What is the hardest part for you of being a physician, specifically an oncologist?
The biggest part is dealing with insurance companies, the cost of care. So a lot of times we write prescriptions and patients don't fill them because they don't have the money to buy the medications. And then insurance companies want us to get authorization for every little thing. You order a CAT scan, you got to call them. You order every, suppose you pick three drugs for your patient, for example, chemotherapy, you have to call them for every single drug. It delays patient care. You know, everybody criticizes the British medicine, but this doesn't happen there. If you get cancer, you don't have to worry about going bankrupt. You don't have to worry about, do I buy groceries or do I buy medications, you know? So that is a frustrating part.
What motivated you to open your own private practice?
Because I chose patient care. So the difference in private practice and in a big hospital is in private practice, you know your patients and they know you. So when they call you middle of the night, on the weekend, you know exactly who you're talking to, you know what their problems are, you can help them faster. Versus in a big hospital, when you call, the person on call may not know who you are. And this is before the computers came. Now, of course, they have computers, they can go in and check your medical records, but still they don't know you. You know, so that's what I decided, better for me to go and do my own, take care of my own patients. Mm-hmm.
And how have you seen the medical field change over the years that you've been involved?
So, you know, it has become more and more corporate medicine now. The show is now being run by insurance companies versus being run by physicians. Previously, there was a physician-patient relationship. Now there's a physician here and a patient here, and the middle is sitting the insurance companies. They're literally running the show now. Mm-hmm. That is a frustrating part. Mm-hmm. And patients don't understand. Patients blame physicians or blame hospitals, but they don't know it's... Till the insurance company says yes, our hands are tied.
Mm-hmm. Have you faced any discrimination throughout your professional career?
Not really. I was so busy taking care of patients. The only thing I've noticed is, if you look at hospitals, if you take any hospital in Houston, there's huge diversity in the patients, huge diversity in the nurses, big diversity in the physicians. But when it comes to the C-suite, that's majority white. Mm. That, I think that's a big discrimination that I see.
Yeah.
What is the C-suite?
The corp, where the CEO, all the administration is.
Okay, Chelsey, do you want to take over for the
second? Oh, yeah. So now we're going to ask some questions about the Indo-American Charity Foundation. Can you describe your experience with it and how you were involved?
So what happened in my office one day, I had a patient, an elderly woman, I think she was about 80 years old. So I wrote a prescription and gave her the prescription, and she said, Doc, do you have any samples? I said, no, I didn't have any samples. She said, I don't have money to buy medication. So I said, how come you don't have money? You just got your Medicare check. She said, yes, but by the time I pay rent and buy dog food, there's no money left. So I said, get rid of your dog. She said, I don't have a dog. I eat dog food to survive. And I just stood in front of her, froze. I said, oh my God, this is the richest country in the world, and this 80-year-old has to eat dog food to survive. So, I mean, I could sleep. So I got a few friends together on a weekend. I said, look, this is what's going on here. Why don't we get together? And we won't be able to help everybody, but we can start somewhere, try to help people. So that's how gradually we built up, and we had a first get together in an Indian restaurant in Southwest, and our chief guest was Marvin Zindler. I don't know if you know him. He used to be a big TV reporter. He never showed up. But we collected $10,000 and we gave all the money to the food bank. Mm. And then gradually we started growing into bigger and bigger things. Mm. But that's how we started.
So how did you, who were the main donors of the money that helped you build the organization?
In the building, in the beginning, we had a bunch of physicians, mm-hmm. and I don't know if you want the names, I can name them, a few of them, but it was a few physicians who got together, and then mm-hmm. gradually we started going to the business community, and then, of course, people who work for big companies, they started having matching funds, mm-hmm. then it kept growing.
And how big is the organization now?
I don't know how many members they have, because I sort of backed off and let the next generation take over, come with mm-hmm. new ideas. But they still collect almost $300,000 to $400,000 a year mm-hmm. and distribute it.
So what are some past or current projects that the organization has worked on?
So mainly when we started out with the food bank. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, they've gone into sponsoring students for scholarships. Mm-hmm. I think they have other projects going on right now. They have a clinic. They support a clinic. Mm-hmm. And the clinic is every Saturday open to anybody who can walk in free of charge. They have primary care there. They have a dentist comes in there. Mm-hmm. They have eye clinic there. Then they also work with abused children and women. Mm-hmm. They support there, which is a different organization, but Charity Foundation helps them financially. So those are big projects they do. Mm-hmm. Then of course, when we had the floods, they helped out a lot during that time.
Mm-hmm. What are the main demographics that the organization supports, or is there a target demographic?
There's no target. Everybody, as long as it's in Houston, mm-hmm. all the money stays in Houston. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter who you are, whoever needs help, they try to help, mm-hmm. regardless. Like the clinic, for example, anybody can walk in. It's not open mm-hmm. just to Indians, but it's mm-hmm. everybody. Same thing in their charity work. It's open to everybody who needs help.
And who are the supporters or workers in the organization?
All the workers are voluntary, nobody gets paid. And there are physicians, there are engineers, business people, and now a lot of the younger people, students are taking part in, they are joining it, you know, the next generation.
Can you describe how you were able to grow the organization?
I think the best way to grow an organization is to convince people why you need it. Mm-hmm. Our biggest job was to convince them, look, let's help Houston. That's here we live, let's help Houston first. You know, these are all our neighbors, they need help. So it takes time, but slowly people were convinced. And then we got their children involved as volunteers in the food bank or in the clinics. So the next generation was pushing parents and their friends, so it gradually grew, but it took time.
What do you think were the main challenges in developing the organization?
The main challenges is that already there are so many other organizations, mm-hmm. and when you go to people for money or for their time, they say, well, I'm already donating money here, I'm spending my time over here, and there's only so much they can give. So those are the challenges, to try to get people to still give us money and get new people to come in and donate their time, donate their money.
Mm-hmm. What other organizations does the foundation work with? And are there other organizations in Houston that are similar? Can you describe those?
I think there are some other organizations also doing the same. And we try to help each other if we can. Mm-hmm. But like I mentioned earlier, DEA is an organization where they're helping abused children and wives. It covers mostly Indian Pakistanis right now, mm-hmm. but anybody can ask for help. So that's one big organization they're helping. They still help Houston Food Bank mm-hmm. and the charity clinic.
So you mentioned these different activities, like giving scholarships to students and helping women and children. Are these activities scheduled on a regular basis?
I think the school scholarships they do twice a year or three times a year, depending on the school year. Mm-hmm. And as far as the DEA goes, DEA has activities 2-3 times a year, mm-hmm. but Charity Foundation gives them money up front, mm-hmm. and they can organize their things, do their planning, whichever they want to do. Same thing they do with the clinic, they give them money mm-hmm. as needed.
Mm-hmm. So does the funding come primarily from individual donations, or have you reached out to corporations or through United Way for support?
A lot of money comes from individuals. But a lot of the corporations are also helping, like Memorial Hermann helps, mm-hmm. St. Luke's, Methodist, they help. And the big oil companies will help with matching funds. Some of the small companies which are owned by the Indian Pakistani community, they will help too. Mm-hmm. So it's a mixed bag.
So, what do you think is one of the most significant accomplishments that the foundation has achieved to date?
I think the biggest achievement, I would say, is making the community and the next generation, the awareness that it has increased, that there are people here in our Houston community who need help, and we need to help them.
What are your future goals for the organization?
I'm in the background, mm-hmm. but I think they need to get bigger and bigger mm-hmm. and continue helping the ones they're already helping. Because you can't help everybody. So if we can focus on this group, mm-hmm. hopefully it can grow more, get more money, more support.
In your opinion, what do you think is most needed for the Indian American community in Houston that still needs to be worked on?
most needed for the community. You know, right now, what I'll tell you, I was going to my closet and my wife's closet. I saw hundreds and hundreds of clothes which have been unused. My clothes is not a problem. My shirts and pants I can give to any charity, right? Mm-hmm. But my wife's clothes, I saw her Indian saris, this one, which she cannot donate to local charities. Mm-hmm. So my job now, next job, is to talk to them to see how these clothes can be given to the Indian Pakistani community who needs it locally, mm-hmm. and if there's any way of sending it to South Asia where it could be used. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be my next project.
Cool. So do you feel like you are part of a strong South Asian community in Houston?
Yeah, I think.
Which communities are you active in?
Mostly my friends are professionals. So I'm usually spend my time more with professionals, you know, physicians, engineers, businessmen. So that's where most of my activity is. Mm.
And how do you think Houston and its South Asian or immigrant community has changed over time?
I think the first generation like me, we had a lot of learning to do. I think it was very easy for our kids. They were born here, you know, they grew up over here. And so I hope they continue some of the traditions of giving down the road. So I think that's the challenge. Was that the question?
Oh, I was asking how you think South Asian communities have changed over time in Houston.
I think the first generation when we came in, we were all professionals. I think now all we thought was medicine, engineering, law, being accountant. That's the only four professions we ever thought of. Now I'm seeing kids going into other professions like opening restaurants. I have a niece who's a sommelier. You know, we never knew what sommelier means. We have kids going into acting, different professions. So I think that's a big change.
Did you have expectations for your own children when they were growing up?
I wanted them all to go to medicine. None of them did. I have three. Nobody went to medicine.
What do they do now?
So my oldest is a pharmacist, close to medicine. Her name is Vanita. And my second daughter, Varsha, she did hospital administration. So I thought she'll run a hospital. She moved to Austin, and she is doing real estate. And my son, actually, he studied here at Rice University. He did an MBA over here, and he works for Shell.
How did you meet your wife?
So my wife, my dad, and her dad were friends in college. So their friendship sort of continued. They worked in a bank, and they were always friends. So we knew each other. It was like going to uncle's house. And then when I finished medical school, so my dad asked me, he said, do you have a girlfriend? Are you seeing somebody? I said, no. He said, what do you think about her? I said, her? We grew up together, no way. And I think her parents asked her the same question. Are you seeing somebody? You have a friend? She said, no. She said, what do you think about the North? She said, no way. They said, okay, think about it. Then we went out and we said, oh my God, we never thought of each other. That's how it happened. So in a way, semi-arranged.
Do you feel like your relationship is stronger because you've known each other for so long?
I think it's more trying to understand each other and not always having your own way. You know, talking to each other. We've been married 47 years now. So,
So going back to your kids, did you try to maintain Indian culture with them?
Not much. Mm-hmm. A little bit, I would say. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you were focused on, or what do you think you were focused on when you were raising them?
I just wanted them to educate themselves and be good citizens, you know. Mm-hmm. My daughter-in-law is a Chinese, so I never pushed them into, you have to only marry Indian or none of that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They went to ballet, mm-hmm. they piano lessons, like, so we didn't push them too much into Indian culture, no.
Mm-hmm. How do you balance your work life and your personal life?
When I was working, I used to work mm-hmm. 12 to 14 hours a day. It was all work, work, work.
Mm-hmm.
And personal life, I tried to spend as much time with my children and with my family. But time was very little for personal
mm-hmm.
life.
Mm-hmm. How do you identify? Do you consider yourself Indian, Indian-American?
Well, I've lived most of my life in America now.
Mm-hmm.
So being, since I was born in India, I grew up in India, that cannot never get out of you. The Indianness will always be inside you.
Mm-hmm.
But I also consider myself American.
Mm-hmm.
So when I visit India, if somebody criticizes America, I really get mad. So I argue,
mm-hmm.
maybe even get caught.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's the American side of me.
Mm-hmm.
But I love Indian food, Indian music. That will always be within you.
So do you have any hobbies now?
You know, I retired in September. I still work part-time, few days.
Mm-hmm.
I walk. Now my wife is going to push me into yoga. She's been trying, which I know she'll win.
Mm-hmm.
I like to read.
Mm-hmm.
I have not taken up golf yet, although I have a set of big set of golf clubs. Hopefully, one day I'll start.
And what do you think is your greatest accomplishment in life so far?
I think my greatest accomplishment is becoming a physician, taking care of patients, and generally being a good citizen.
Mm. Sophie, do you have any more questions?
I have a specific question. DAYA, is that D-A-Y-A?
Y-A,
yeah. What does that stand for?
I think DAYA means giving. I think in Hindi or
so
Sanskrit.
It's not an acronym.
I think in Hindi or Sanskrit it means charity or giving.
Okay.
That's why.
Are you familiar with DAYA, Chelsey?
I did an interview a couple months ago with one of the people who works at DAYA. So she told
me. Is that what it told you, the meaning of DAYA?
I don't remember that part.
DAYA, I think the main word DAYA means charity.
Okay.
I think that's what it really means, giving.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I think that's all the questions we had for you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much for coming in.